Good afternoon. Welcome to the Nebraska State Historical Society's Museum of Nebraska History. My name is Brent Carmack. I'm the Associate Director for Museum and Historic Sites, and want to welcome you to the January, the first in of the 2004 Brown Bags. Want to note that funding for the filming, the taping of these Brown Bags to be shown on TV has been generously provided by the Nebraska State Historical Society Foundation. Today, we are going to hear from Deborah Long, who is the head objects conservator at the Gerald R. Ford Conservation Center, which is a division of the Nebraska State Historical Society that's located in Omaha. She's been with the Historical Society since 1996. She came to the Historical Society from the Winterthur Museum in Delaware, where she was an assistant objects conservator. During her time at the Winterthur, she served as the Delaware Save Our Outdoor Sculpture Advisory Board and trained volunteers to carry out sculpture surveys. Her talk today is going to be about the Save Our Outdoor Sculpture program. Deborah Long.
Thanks, Brent. I hope everybody can hear me. I have a tendency to trail off, so. Well, as Brent mentioned, I'm here to talk about the SOS program, which does mean Save Outdoor Sculpture. This is a program that was started in the 80s. It's jointly sponsored by the National Institute for Conservation of Cultural Property, which has since had a name change to Heritage Preservation, along with the National Museum of American Art, which is part of the Smithsonian Institution. The SOS program has two main goals. Number one is to locate and report on the condition of all publicly accessible outdoor sculpture in the U.S. And number two, maybe the more important function, is to raise public awareness about outdoor sculpture and its place in America. Now, the first part of that, which is locating and reporting on the condition of sculpture, requires a certain amount of training. And as Brent mentioned, I did do volunteer training during the 90s. And those training programs attracted a wide variety of people in local arts councils, people who worked as volunteers in communities. All different kinds of people were attracted to those programs. And the training was very straightforward, but basically the first part of what they were supposed to do was to go out and find outdoor sculpture, which sounds like such an easy thing to do. And can be very easy depending on the town that you're in. People surveyed sculptures and searched for sculptures in almost every way. This is a person in New York who basically drove his motorcycle around the entire region and just made lists of all the sculpture he could find. And these are some graduate students in the Winterthur Art Conservation Program that I worked with to go around and look for sculptures in our region. Now, what the training entailed was essentially to teach people how to look at sculpture the way a curator or a conservator might look at it from the surveying perspective. They learned how to measure sculpture, what the important measurements were. They learned how to photo document the sculpture, and they did both black and white and color photography. They learned how to make sure that they captured all of the information that was important for the survey. And the survey included lots of different people, both adults and children. We did have a lot of scouts working on this project as well. Now, some of the things that they also learned how to describe and look for were condition features that a lot of outdoor sculpture exhibits. Things like frost damage that you can see on the left here. This object is really breaking up from frost. And also accidental or vandalizing types of damage. The little tail you see there was actually damaged by children climbing on that sculpture and bouncing up and down on it. They learned about the problems with animals in the environment. Bird droppings can be a terrible problem for sculpture. They also were taught to note things like the sculpture you see on the right, which is actually installed incorrectly directly on the ground instead of being put on a base. And that's something important to know about because that's going to affect the long-term stability of the object. Another thing we talked about during the training was environmental damage, and this is a very prevalent problem. This sculpture you can see is by Zorak. It has quite a bit of environmental damage because it's in an urban environment on the East Coast. There's a lot of acid rain problem because of the industrial nature of that part of the country. But it also has another problem. It's not very easy to see in the slide, but the slide on the right is a detail of some gunshot dents in the side of the leg, which was unfortunate. Other more obvious types of vandalism that they might encounter on the sculptures were things like painted graffiti or actual theft of parts of sculptures. On the right, you can see that the sculpture has lost its sword and scabbard, and basically there's just a strapping just hanging there down the back of the sculpture, and whenever the wind blows, it just flops around. Now, all this documentation that they collected, they collated it all, they had their slides developed, they labeled them appropriately, they collected supporting documentation from local newspaper sources, and in some cases, they did have a difficult time collecting information on sculptures. As you can see, these two divers are surveying a sculpture in Florida. So once they collected all of the information, they sent it to the National Museum of Art, where it was added to the Inventory of American Sculpture. And this is a national resource that's available on the web now. The inventory was begun in 1986 when 24,000 records from an index of American sculpture administered by the University of Delaware were transferred to the NMAA and developed into an online database. The data collected showed that the bulk of American sculpture was produced and dedicated around the turn of the 19th to the early 20th century, and many of the sculptures commemorated the Civil War. Another thing they found was that as they collected the data, they were able to begin to develop some idea of what the overall condition of sculpture in America was. And what they found was that nearly half of America's sculpture is in need of conservation of some type, and that out of all of these items, about 1 in 11 were urgently in need of some kind of treatment. Now, while this project was going on, the SOS volunteers and paid staff were also working on preparing a number of books, kits, brochures, and related to different facets of the project. The most general book, which is called Tips, Tales, and Testimonials to Save Outdoor Sculpture, is a compendium of information designed to help interested volunteers increase community awareness, develop advocacy, and raise funds for the care of sculpture in their communities. Maintenance of Outdoor Sculpture, a bibliography, provides a variety of references regarding deterioration processes, treatment research, and care issues. Another publication, Designing Outdoor Sculpture, aims at helping those involved with the commissioning of sculpture consider the long-term care needs and maintenance costs when they're in the planning phase of a project. The Adopt a Monument kit contains a video as well as written information that helps interested volunteers make connections with local officials and business owners to focus their attention on the care of individual sculptures in communities. Other books, like the SOS Volunteer Handbook, contain specific information and recommendations relating to the production of complete and well-documented survey reports. The overarching thread of all the publications is really community awareness. The project really generated a number of articles in regionally and nationally distributed publications. And as you can see, here's just a sampling of some of the ones, some of the publications. And there were also a number of newspaper articles as projects proceeded in towns across the country. It's always very popular to put something like this in your local paper. As of 1999, the program had achieved the survey of more than 32,000 sculptures around the country. And they were very proud of this. Now, once the surveys have been done, then conservators can go back and assess the sculptures that are found to be in need of more help. This is an example of some conservators working on assessment of sculptures. On the right is Virginia Naudé. She's a prominent outdoor sculpture conservator. And you never know what kind of situation you're going to have to be in order to actually assess the condition of a sculpture. You may be on scaffolding, you may be in a truck, you may be on ladders. It just depends on the sculpture. But between 1997 and 2003, SOS awarded about 250 assessment grants covering more than 500 sculptures. Now, these are two examples of Theo Alice Ruggles Kitson's The Hiker. On the left is the one in Massachusetts, and on the right is one in Arizona. These assessments were actually used for a secondary purpose beyond just treating the individual sculptures. There are about 50 of these hiker sculptures around the country that were examined, and they were all assessed as part of a research project on the effect of acid rain, and they were able to correlate some of the problems in industrial environmental pollution to the condition of these sculptures. The locations of the sculpture allowed differing environmental conditions to be highlighted. And Dr. David Ames, who's the director of Center for Historic Architecture and Engineering at the University of Delaware, correlated this damage to other environmental data. And the information has been used to help guide future care and maintenance of the sculptures. Now, most sculpture assessments really do just look at those individual sculptures. And these are two examples. On the left is Jonathan Taggart, who's a sculpture conservator on the West Coast. He works primarily in the Northwest. And on the right is Glenn Morton with a sculpture of Buffalo Bill. And he works primarily in the Southwest and California. And during these assessments, what conservators do is they test the surfaces, they analyze the materials, they look at the deterioration processes, they bring in instruments to look at the inside armature of the sculpture so they can really have a good sense of what the actual condition of the object is, because some types of damage are not readily apparent. So I just wanted to show a few examples of some of the things that they found and what actually happened with them. This is a sculpture called Indian Hunter by John Quincy Adams Ward, and it's located in Urbana, Ohio. And this is just a before and after treatment shot. Between 1998 and 2002, 123 public sculptures, at least one in each state plus one in the District of Columbia, received NEA support for conservation through the SOS Conservation Treatment Awards. The program was funded jointly by the NEA and Target stores. You might recognize this sculpture. The awards represent a wide array of artists. They span 137 years between 1853 and 1990, and they're found in all types of public places, including parks, cemeteries, libraries, state capitals, schools, and churches. And on the left, you can see an example of a test cleaning of a sculpture called George McCullough, which is located in Muncie, Indiana. And you can see a dramatic difference from the damaged condition on the left of it to the treated condition on the right. Now, this is a sculpture in Framingham, Massachusetts called the Soldier. And again, it's before and after treatment. It was created as a tribute to the 450 men from Framingham who fought in the Civil War. The sculpture has been outdoors since 1888, and at one point in 1938, it was blown off its base by a hurricane, and its bayonet and scabbard were broken off. But you can see it's back in some reasonable condition now. This is a sculpture called Vanishing Race in Los Angeles, California. And this is a WPA period sculpture that was meant to represent the early California Native Americans. It was treated in 2000, and they removed all the graffiti and paint. And it does still have some evidence of some of that damage because some of it was actually scratched into the surface. This is a sculpture called Joan of Arc. It's in Portland, Oregon, and it was donated to the city by a local physician in the early 20th century, and he wanted a monument for the doughboys of World War I. Nearly all the original gilding had been lost by the time the sculpture was conserved in 2002. Now, while the larger SOS project was going on, the NEA decided that they wanted to look at sculptures that they had already funded for creation. So they went to the SOS, and SOS initiated an effort to survey all of these sculptures. There were 461 sculptures in all, and the funding of Art in Public Places program took place between 1967 and 1992. They found from their survey of these particular objects that 91% of the works were documented, and of those, 330 fit the criteria for outdoor sculpture. As in the larger SOS project, nearly half of the NEA-funded sculptures were found to need conservation. This is called La Grande Vitesse by Alexander Calder. It's in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And this is the first project funded by the Arts in Public Places program. And the sculpture has really become an important symbol of Grand Rapids. They use it as part of their city logo. This is a sculpture called Big Red. It's by Bruce Beasley, and it resides in Eugene, Oregon. It had quite a bit of graffiti and problems with the surrounding area. This is Moses by Tony Smith in Seattle. Again, it's before and after. It had to be moved away from its permanent location at some point during its life. This is a sculpture by Mark DeSouvereau in Baltimore called the Undersky One Family. And this didn't require a huge amount of conservation, but it's quite improved by the long-term care. And some of the sculptures that the NEA funded were non-traditional materials, the ones we looked at before, mostly steel, copper alloy. But these sculptures by Jimenez were made of fiberglass, and it can be a difficult material to have in an outdoor environment. It's fine for a few years, but you really do have to maintain it in order to keep it in good condition. A couple of other non-traditional types of sculptures. On the left, this is called Art Tool. And the way this works is it's actually rolled along the beach, and in that large cylinder is a relief of the city of Los Angeles. And so when you roll it across the beach, you end up with a map on the sand. And you can imagine the conservation needs of an object like this are quite different from traditional copper alloy sculpture. On the right is Fingerspan by Jody Pinto. That's in Fairmount Park in Philadelphia. It's actually a footbridge in the shape of a finger that's stretched across a gorge along a walking trail in the park. This is an unfortunate object. This is a sculpture called Toth in Rapid City, South Dakota. And unfortunately, less than 30 years after it was created, the sculpture had to be condemned and destroyed because it was unsafe due to lack of maintenance and conservation. Neglect and use of non-traditional material has put many of the NEA sculptures at risk, despite the fact that they're not that old. Now, for sculptures that are in relatively good condition, conservators carry out maintenance assessments. And these plans are developed to help maximize the lifespan of these objects in their settings. Effective preservation maintenance plans can be as simple as periodic washing. With appropriate training, even children can help with these types of simple maintenance projects. Conservators have developed maintenance training plans for specific sculptures for unpaid volunteers, or they've trained city or county workers. Even the artists are asked to get involved. And in this particular case on the right, this is Steve Dickey. He's the artist who created the object, and he's working with a city employee to develop a training maintenance program. Now, in some cases, a little bit more complicated techniques of maintenance can sometimes be carried out by conservators working with groups of volunteers, and this happens quite a bit. This is Lee Axe on the left. He's the sculpture conservator at the Hirshhorn, which is part of the Smithsonian in Washington. Some commissioning agencies now require artists to provide maintenance recommendations and document materials used when they create sculptures. And this kind of information really makes it a lot easier in the future when somebody comes back to do maintenance, because with any city government or county government, you have a change of people over time. And if you don't have good documentation, it's difficult for people later to figure out exactly what was going on in the past. Now, another really important part of SOS is the public outreach and awareness aspects. There are all kinds of SOS activities that are developed to attract children, to get parents involved, all kinds of community activities. In 2000, SOS hosted a National Sculpture Day across the country. Communities participated in this program. In Cleveland, there were children who had activities such as a ring toss activity where they basically made cutouts of some of the sculptures in the city and used them as little activities for the kids. And then also people did things like rededicating their city sculpture, having parades, all kinds of different things. Now this is sculpture of King Kamehameha from 1880 by Thomas Ridgway Gould. There are actually four of these sculptures. One actually never made it all the way to Hawaii before it sank in its ship. It was later pulled up and repaired and installed. But originally this sculpture was gilt, and it was meant to be gold all over. However, over time it had been painted in lifelike colors for many years, and there was a big community controversy about whether they should return the sculpture to its original gilded appearance or whether they should leave it a painted appearance. It was a big issue, and they actually ended up holding a vote on what they should do about it, and the community decided they wanted it to stay painted. So this is a little scene from their rededication ceremony, where they had all kinds of activities. In this case, they had a puppet show. They had dancers, and the sculpture was draped in leis. So this happened in 2001. The Joan of Arc sculpture that I showed earlier from Oregon was rededicated. And during the course of the sculpture conservation, they found that they had to remake a wreath that she had had on her head, and also the flag that you see her carrying. It took about 3 troy ounces of gold to cover her. And these are just a couple of views of kids' activities during the rededication ceremony. Now, one thing you've seen several times during this talk is some pictures of scouts. The Girl Scouts have been actually a really important part of the SOS program. It's a great program for them. They've worked all around the country to raise money and raise awareness. They've learned an awful lot about outdoor sculpture and about volunteering in their communities. They've learned about women's roles in some of the outdoor sculpture activities, which has been really great for them. SOS created a little Girl Scout patch that they could receive based on activities that involved them with local history in their community. And on the left is the Girl Scout troop in Reading, Massachusetts. And they were the first ones to receive the SOS patch. And in their community, they created a map of all of the sculpture in their town. Another public awareness part of SOS is this education kit and booklet called Inside Outdoor Sculpture. This is an interdisciplinary resource guide, and it has a kit that can be borrowed from SOS. There are also related lesson plans that are available on the web. There are sculpture cards that can be downloaded into classrooms. And the kit provides a number of different activities that children, both younger children and older children, can participate in. And these are all designed to help students see sculpture in new and different ways. One of the last activities that SOS carries out to raise awareness is this traveling exhibit that we have here at the Historical Society now. This traveling exhibit was set up so that each state would have an individual front panel that talked about a particular sculpture in their state. And when you go out later, you'll be able to see that exhibit called Preserving Memory, America's Monumental Legacy. Now, as was mentioned earlier, the NSHS has this exhibit open now at the Museum of Nebraska History. And from here, it will go to the state capitol, where it will be up until the end of February. And after that, it will open in early March in Omaha at the Gerald R. Ford Conservation Center, where it will stay up through nearly the end of April. I wanted to actually also give you a little bit of information. If you want to go to the web, you can go to SOS's homepage. It's located at heritagepreservation.org. You can also go and look up the Inventory of American Sculpture, and that's located at cirrus.si.edu. Any questions?
Responsibility for restoring the sculpture when it's considered damaged. Is it a local group, or is someone assigned from elsewhere, or how does that work?
Well, it depends on who owns the sculpture. A lot of these activities are volunteer-based activities, and usually an interested group will get together and go to the mayor or the city council or something, and it, you know, if it's a publicly owned sculpture. And then they'll try to do fundraising, develop funding sources, write grants, things like that. It's not normal that an outside person would come in and do a repair without any local input for public sculpture.
And it always requires some sponsor to get things going.
Well, usually there's an interested group who's kind of adopted that object or has some feeling about it. So they're usually the ones who spearhead the work that's involved in raising awareness and raising funds. So it really depends on the individual sculpture.
Are any of them ever beyond repair and taken away?
Well, some of them, but not really very many. And different communities make different decisions about what they're going to do. I was talking to a lady in western Nebraska just last week about a sculpture that was damaged. The community decided to take it down and make a bronze replacement for it. So they'll retain the original sculpture indoors someplace in storage, and they'll put up their new bronze sculpture for the public. So,
Do you have any idea approximately how much money has been given in conservation and assessment grants through SOS over the term of the program?
Not in particularly in conservation grants, but the program's given about more than $1.2 million in matching funds over time, overall. And I don't know how that breaks down from one grant to the other, but of course, most grants that are offered, there's usually a match of some kind, usually 50% or more match. So it is leveraged by these other funds that are developed. So it's quite a bit of money that's been generated by this through community outreach.
Do you know how many sculptures Lincoln, Nebraska has?
I don't know exactly how many are in Lincoln. I know there are something more than 240 in Nebraska, but I can't tell you exactly how many of those are in Lincoln.
I noticed that in some of the bronzes, that when they were cleaned, they were put back to original condition.
Uh-huh.
Then did they put a finish on them to keep them in that bronze?
Yes. Yes, yes, that's a very good question. Normally what happens is you do need to remove the corrosion that's on the surface. If there are any old original coatings that are deteriorated, you remove all of those. Once you get the surface clean, then you have to decide based on appearance if it needs more interventive actions like repatination or things like that. Conservators always try to do the most minimally intrusive things they can do, because of course you want the sculpture to stay as close to original as possible, and you don't want to reinterpret the artist's original intent. So what they do is, there are a variety of different types of coatings that they can apply to the surfaces, and it's dependent on future maintenance activities, it's dependent on the location of the sculpture, it's dependent on the weather conditions. A lot of different factors go into making that decision. A fairly common coating is a wax coating. It tends to weather off over time, just like you wax your car, and after some time the wax does disappear. And so it requires regular maintenance, and it requires a commitment to be relatively regularly maintained. In some other situations, they apply organic lacquer coatings. It just depends on the situation.
Is, in terms of giving grants, is consideration ever given to a collection or a particular artist, or is it always just an individual piece that is considered?
You mean giving money to a whole group of things?
Correct, yeah.
Most of the ones I've seen have been one grant, one sculpture. Of course, you know, I'm sure if you had a group of sculptures that were all related, you might ask for a grant for all of them. especially if they were put up at similar times or they all related to one another in some way. So, any other questions?
How do you determine what's original patination and what is further corrosion or oxidation?
That's a very good question. That can actually be sometimes a little bit tricky. You spend a lot of time doing research on the original artist, what their normal working methods were. Sometimes you can find foundry records. You can go back to the public record if it was a publicly commissioned sculpture and look at the public records to see if there were any if there are any parameters that were set at the beginning. Often during the process of creation, there will be meetings, and sometimes there will be notes about those meetings. Artists sometimes create maquettes that they paint to approximate the appearance so they can make a presentation. So you look for a lot of different places. And then on the sculpture itself, conservators spend a lot of time looking very closely at the surface in all different locations to try to determine what the corrosion patterns mean and where they can find places that are a little bit less damaged. And there's usually some place that's somewhat less damaged than others that will give you a little bit of idea. They look through old newspapers to find information from dedications to see if the sculpture was described. So there's a lot of different ways to approach that problem. Anybody else? Well, thank you very much.